last all clear had gone. The war was over. But what would the peace hold for the men and women who had fought to overthrow fascism? What would it be like to live in a world over which hung the threat of atomic weapons? What would come of their desire for a new social order?
The expectations were very high of people in 1945, of that Labour government. You've got people saying there'll never be another Tory government after that election result. You know, things are going to change, we're the bosses now. The men who were coming back from the services, and they had an outlook that is different to anything now, that no way was they going to be ruled again.
In 1945, Labour was elected with a majority of 146 seats over all other parties. In the election campaign, the Tories had tried a repetition of the Red Scare of the 20s. The electors were being forced to choose, they said, between free enterprise and thoroughgoing socialism. In fact, the Labour government had no plans and, above all, no political theory that would lead to a radical transformation of British society, or even to a reform of its institutions, for instance by abolishing the House of Lords. It thought of socialism as the continuation of the centralised government planning that had been imposed in wartime. But many people were confident that this was a turning point in British politics. The new government faced grave economic difficulties. They were made worse when America abruptly ended the wartime arrangements for aid to Britain and imposed harsh conditions for an Anglo-US loan. America had emerged as the greatest capitalist power, holding more than two-thirds of the world's gold reserves. It would use its power to shape the economics and politics of the capitalist world.
Following World War II, the United States followed very enlightened policies in terms of an open world of free trade and free investment and competition and free movement of people, the most open world, and was also a very stable world. And so this was one of the periods of freedom to invest, of freedom to trade, of freedom of economic intercourse, of freedom of people to move, stability and freedom.
Freedom meant the opportunity for American capital to capture markets for U.S. exports and gain access to raw materials. The devastation of much of Europe facilitated this process. In August 1945, an atomic bomb was dropped on the city of Hiroshima in Japan. There was a death toll of 200,000 and a legacy of sickness that still lingers among the survivors. Three days later, a similar atrocity was carried out on the city of Nagasaki. Significantly, the bomb was used first on Asians and not on Europeans. The United States claimed that the bomb was dropped to end the war quickly and to save the lives of American soldiers. But one reason for the haste was to prevent Russian involvement in the occupation of Japan. The dropping of the bomb was not so much the last act of the Second World War as the first act in the Cold War. The Soviet Union responded by developing its own bomb. The arms race had begun.
One has got to understand, I think, the world setting, of course, of 1945. The defeat of fascism. Change has taken place in Eastern Europe. The control by partisans in large areas of France and Italy, communism governments, the beginning of an upsurge for national independence from imperialism in India and in other countries. Change is beginning to take place in the Middle East. And the ruling class in this country felt the tide is moving very decisively against us. and were really worried.
Nothing stands between Europe today and complete subjugation to communist tyranny but the atomic bomb in American possession.
In the West, politicians like Ernest Bevin, the Labour Foreign Secretary, were obsessed with the need to prevent an extension of Russian influence. In Greece, in the last days of the war, Churchill had intervened on the side of the right against the communist partisans. In the civil war that followed, American arms ensured the victory of the monarchist forces. At the end of the war, the old imperial powers were determined to maintain colonial rule. In Britain, both parties still looked on the empire as a source of cheap raw materials and food, which would help the country overcome its economic difficulties. But in the colonies, something had changed. The independence movements had grown in strength during the war and were pressing for a break with Europe. During the war, the Japanese had occupied what we now know as Vietnam, then part of the French colony Indochina. When the Japanese surrendered, a liberation movement which had fought the invaders proclaimed a republic under Ho Chi Minh. British forces arrived to take charge of Japanese prisoners. Their commander was General Gracie.
Prior to our arrival in Saigon, French collaborators had been imprisoned by the provisional government, the Vietnamese committee, and Gracie gave orders for the release of the French from the prison in Saigon. He armed them, and of course on the 23rd they carried out the coup d'etat, attacked the building in which the Viet Minh Committee was meeting, and from then on, there was bloodshed on the streets of Saigon.
Japanese troops were used to fight the insurgents. British soldiers sent a letter of protest to Ernest Bevin, the Labour Foreign Secretary.
The British are the ranks of this section have sent the following to the Foreign Secretary. It appears that we are collaborating with the Japanese and French forces against the nationalist forces of Viet Minh. For what purposes is this collaboration? Why are we not disarming the Japanese? We desire a definition of government policy regarding the presence of British troops in Indochina.
By the end of 1945, 50,000 French troops had arrived in the country and colonial rule was partially restored. The British intervention, backed by the Labour government, had terrible consequences for the people of Vietnam.
If the British had accepted the fact, and it was a fact, that the Vietnamese were in charge when we arrived, that Ho Chi Minh had set up a government and they were able to run the country. If that had been accepted and the Vietnamese allowed to carry on with their business, then Britain, America, France would not have been involved, and they would have started from 1945 to build a socialist Vietnam.
In spite of severe economic problems and the intense antagonism of the bulk of the press, Labour put through a major programme of reform in its first 2 years in office. In 1946, the National Health Service was set up. It was bitterly resisted by the British Medical Association. Anuren Bevin, the rebel from the left of the party, fought the bill through Parliament and established a service based not on ability to pay, but on need. Labour's legislation failed to improve the position of women. It shared the deep-rooted trade union prejudice against the permanent employment of married women. Wartime nursery facilities were allowed to lapse. Bevan did not include birth control in the National Health Service. Legislation over social security assumed that a woman is dependent on her husband. But the economic situation and the labour shortage created a demand for women workers. After the war, they did not all simply return to housework. Many moved into lower paid jobs.
They advertised in the press for someone in the workshop, so I go along and ask for the job. Of course, they absolutely flabbergasted them, a woman coming for the job. And I said, well, I'd been working in engineering and I'm sure I could fit in somehow or other. Anyway, they all know they weren't taking women on, they wouldn't take a woman on at all. So they offered me a job in the stores and I refused this. I could have taken it because I had previously worked in the stores, but I refused it on principle because I thought, well, why couldn't I be considered for an engineering job?
Austerity reigned. Huge amounts of foreign investments had been sold off during the war. The country had massive debts. Workers had to be persuaded to step up production.
A greater output of coal is absolutely vital.
Let's put all our energy and cheerfulness into this job of building up our prosperity. We need a steady pull and a long pull. With our hearts in our work, so that we get more and yet more production.
The Labour government put through an extensive programme of nationalisation, which included the Bank of England, the mining industry, the railways, road haulage and the waterways. What in fact happened was that the most unprofitable sectors of British industry were taken over by the state. The massive compensation to the previous owners released huge sums for profitable private investment. But these compensation payments placed a crippling burden on the nationalised industries.
It was a massive undertaking to restructure the British economy after 1945. So even business people, you know, were quite happy to see the basic industries nationalised. I mean, something very big like that had to be done. Now, that's what it meant, you know, to a very big segment of the population, including people who are not on our side.
But there was no question of workers' control or even of meaningful workers' participation in the nationalised industries. The Labour Chancellor of the Exchequer, Sir Stafford Cripps, declared that few British workers were capable of taking over large enterprises, even if it were desirable.
In the South Wales coalfield, we had a general appointed in charge of the South Wales South West Division, and the most ruthless colliery company was the Powell Dufferin, and their chief engineers were placed in control of every region in the South Wales coalfield.
The proposed nationalisation of profitable sectors was resisted by business interests. The nationalisation of steel was delayed by the opposition of the steel magnates and the House of Lords. They had the support of men like Alfred Edwards, a former Labour MP.
This would be the beginning of a communist state. Last November in Czechoslovakia, I talked with socialist statesmen who had started nationalising, and 3 months later they were overthrown by communists without an election. The workers have lost their freedom, work longer hours, and have lower living standards. If we lose the battle for steel, we might as well have lost the Battle of Britain.
In 1947, America offered Europe massive aid. It was used to strengthen American interests and to block the possibility of a socialist Europe that would no longer be in the American orbit.
When it became clear that the U.S. alone now had the means to preserve Europe from possible convulsion,
there stepped onto the stage of world affairs a figure destined to usher in a new era of American foreign policy, George Catlett Marshall.
It is logical that the United States should do whatever it is able to do to assist in the return of normal economic health in the world. It would be neither fitting nor efficacious for this government to undertake to draw up unilaterally a program designed to place Europe on its feet economically. This is the business of the Europeans.
Across the Atlantic, one man, Ernest Bevin, grabbed with both hands, in his own words, the hint which Marshall gave.
In 1947, India became independent in line with a wartime commitment by the British government.
I don't believe that the Labour government gave independence to India. I think Indian independence was achieved by India. Under Stafford Cripps, mission was sent in India, and they had a sort of extensive tour all over India. They met all sort of parties, political parties, sections and others. But surely they came back with a sort of clear idea that British government will not be able to keep hold India for very long.
The settlement in India aimed to preserve a British economic and political presence even after independence. Power was handed over to nationalist politicians who could be relied on to keep the left in check.
As Lord Mountbatten said, with the departure of the British forces, the outward and visible sign of British rule in India disappears, and its place is taken by something much more valuable, a really great friendship between the British and the Indians.
Fears of social revolution were not without foundation.
You've got to remember, by 1948, Peking fell to the Chinese Red Army, and 800 or 900 million people in China passed under communist rule. And communist parties were being formed in scores of countries that had never had communist parties.
Between 1948 and 1954, British troops were engaged in a brutal colonial war against communists in Malaya.
We had tin, rubber, copper, all our investments in Malaya were under threat if those people got independence on their terms. We had to fight so that a government could be installed that would be independent on our terms, not theirs.
The argument was the balance of payments was held up by the £600 million we got from rubber sales from Malaya, and Britain would collapse unless we had this rubber. Well, the Communist Party said not only was it unethical, immoral, to continue this imperialist war, but that it was economically a load of rubbish. The fact is we were keeping a huge standing army in order to suppress the Malayans and other peoples, of course. And this was part of the British taxpayer, but the profits from the Malayan rubber companies went to the British capitalist class.
One of the weapons used in the war was the forced deportation of whole communities to so-called new villages. It aimed at cutting off the guerrillas from supplies and from their supporters in the local population. The British military commander was Sir Gerald Templer.
He had no compunction in destroying whole communities, moving people from one end of Malaya to the other, where the communists were strongest and had their support. He would destroy a village and move the inhabitants down to Johor Bahru, where there was a very, very friendly puppet ruler, the Sultan of Johor Bahru, educated his children in this country, a proper poodle.
There was horrific stories, but nothing really happened until one day the Daily Worker managed to get a photograph of some British paratroopers sitting surrounded by the hands they'd cut off the guerrillas, both men and women. This was published in the Daily Worker. But you've got to realise that the Labour Party was totally implicated in it. And John Stracey, who's a former left-wing leader, was the war minister at the time. The Labour Party has no credit whatsoever from this particular period.
In late 1946, without consulting the whole cabinet, Attlee had decided to make a British atom bomb. While the programme was underway, Ernest Bevin, speaking at the United Nations, maintained that the Labour government was opposed to atomic warfare.
We continually hear the plea of prohibition of the atomic weapon and an attempt to place blame upon us and others for failing to make prohibition a reality. This is really a stupid charge. We're as anxious as anyone for prohibition.
The facts about the atom bomb and the massive expenditure it entailed were carefully hidden from the British people by the Labour government.
This was London's Army Day, celebrating the anniversary of victory in Europe, and the march covered a route of nearly 7 miles. The Mayor of Westminster took the salute in Trafalgar Square. At Ludgate Hill, in a foolish demonstration, women with placards saying "No more war" got in the way but were quickly dispersed. Bystanders were obviously annoyed. None of us want war, but we do need an army to preserve peace.
In 1948, the Americans established permanent air bases in Britain. The planes were said to be merely on training flights. In 1949, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO, was set up. Ernest Bevin was one of its chief architects. At home, demonstrators attacked Labour's Cold War policies. The Labour left attacked the government for its grovelling attitude towards the Americans, but were reduced to hoping that Labour could at least be a restraining force on the Americans, whose anti-communism had developed into a hysterical witch hunt.
The court is packed with fashionably dressed women, as witness Robert Taylor takes the stand. In answer to a committee question on whether the Communist Party should be outlawed in America, Mr. Taylor replies,
"I personally certainly do believe that the Communist Party should be outlawed. However, I'm not an expert on politics or of what the reaction would be. If I had my way about it, they'd all be sent back to Russia or some other unpleasant place."
The congressional investigation is not a judicial hearing, but refusal to testify results in a contempt of Congress charge. Next on the list of witnesses is Ronald Reagan.
Anti-communism on either side of the Atlantic was greatly strengthened by the information emerging about the huge system of labour camps in Stalin's Russia, by the Soviet-backed coups in Eastern Europe, and the treason trials with their ritual confessions and death sentences. In Britain, the press and the Tory party fostered the idea that socialism and bureaucracy were synonymous. Labour was accused by right-wing pressure groups like the Housewives League of willfully continuing rationing and austerity. Within the Labour Party, the left was in retreat. The Cold War made them open to the dangerous charge of fellow travelling and threats of expulsion.
And for all the talk about the workers and all the sham peace propaganda, communism is today essentially a conspiracy against the liberty of the common people. I don't for a moment think it's going to succeed, but its activities demand constant watchfulness and a high measure of devotion from all who believe in democracy and liberty.
There was a political vacuum on the left into which the Communist Party stepped. It had a strong industrial base. Large numbers of workers followed its lead on bread and butter issues. Both the electricians and fire brigades unions were under communist leadership. During the war, strikes had been made illegal. In the post-war period, the TUC, which was dominated by the right-wing leaders of the miners, the municipal workers and the transport workers, agreed to continue this policy. Yet between 1947 and 1951, there were 8,000 unofficial strikes. Among these were the strikes organised by the unofficial Dockers movement, which was communist-led.
The lads drew up a Docks charter, five-point charter. That was for an increase of wages to 25 shillings a day, increasing the piecework rates paid for piecework, holidays with pay, sick pay and pensions. And of course, we took it through our trade union branches constitutionally, expecting the fact that now we have a Labour government, there was much more progressive attitude about in industry, and we took it through our trade unions. But eventually the cry then, what it has been for many, many years, whenever there's a Labour government in, don't embarrass the Labour government, give it a chance to breathe.
Prime mover in this belated action to protect the national interests is the Prime Minister, reactionary number one, whose broadcast appeal to the nation and the Dockers in particular pointed the path of duty and made clear the dangers of following advice which stems from sources hostile to this country.
When industrial action broke out in defiance of the TUC policy on strikes, the Labour government had no qualms about using troops as blacklegs.
Workers at Brimsdown Power Station in North London bring about a strike that rapidly spreads across the capital. The soldiers and sailors are moved in to keep the plants working. Some of the servicemen were due to go on leave when they were ordered to man the power depots. To Tommy Atkins and Barnacle Bill, it's all the same. In the past 2 years, he's been a coal man, a meat porter, a docker, and now a grid worker.
In October 1948, Arthur Deakin, the right-wing Transport and General Workers Union boss, launched an attack on communists in the unions, where they were opposing the government's policy on wage restraint. The TUC called on all affiliated bodies to exclude them from office.
I was then a chairman, a lay official, elected chairman of the Transport and General Workers Union Dock branch. I was its official chairman. And then I was confronted with a form to sign that I would resign my membership to the Communist Party and I could then hold my position as a lay official or any future vacancies for other positions. And of course, I and the greater numbers I know of the Communist Party refused to sign that form.
The media played an important part in the massive red scare whipped up over the 1951 dock strike.
It's hard to resist the glib promises of agitators. Money doesn't go far today. And because they didn't grow up with the unions like their fathers, they're easily swayed. The unions succeeded because men gave them loyalty. Today, the thoughtless betray their leaders. £900 million of imports and exports pass through Liverpool each year. Stand still at the docks could bring Britain to her knees. And that is what communism wants.
The unofficial docker strike is due to the reckless agitation of a group of saboteurs calling themselves the National Port Workers Committee.
the 10 people causing the stoppage have no sense of responsibility. They are just a bunch of gamblers ready to mislead, then running away from the consequence of their action.
When we met the older deputation to go to Transport House to interview Deacon on the strike that we was involved in, by accident we caught him coming in to go up to his office, and we blocked his way and began to talk to him and explain to him why he wasn't supporting us in our demand, which was justified. That was the question of rates of pay and piecework conditions. And he was very belligerent, and to me he says, "You want to be careful you don't get gravel rash." Well, that was a euphemism for having me set about on the ground and all that sort of thing.
The leaders of the 1951 strike were arrested under the wartime order banning industrial action.
We were more taken back to the fact that a Labour government should prosecute us for striking in order to protect the employer. Once they arrested us, each time that we appeared at the Old Bailey or Bow Street, the docks closed down.
Organised labour's anger caused a climb down by the government. An Old Bailey jury refused to convict the dockers, and the wartime order banning strikes was withdrawn. In 1951, war broke out between communist North Korea and the South, where the Americans had installed a puppet dictator. The United States intervened. Labour was quick to send troops to back up the Americans, who used napalm. They also got Labour's backing for the possible use of the bomb against China, which supported the North Koreans.
The Americans intervened to stop a socialist government taking over the whole of the country. And it was divided at the 38th parallel. And they installed nothing more than a dictator in Syngman Rhee. His record on human rights was appalling. Syngman Rhee was keeping people in concentration camps, just like Adolf Hitler. And the story put about that we'd gone in there to defend democracy was totally untrue. We were there supporting a tottering, disgusting regime that the Americans supported.
British involvement led to a large increase in arms expenditure. At home, Gaitskell, the right-wing Labour Chancellor, faced by the problem of financing the rearmament programme, decided to cut £25 million from the National Health Service and put a 50 pence charge on teeth and spectacles. In protest, Anuiran Bevan resigned from the government and from the Labour Party National Executive. Labour lost the next election, but this did not mean the abandonment of the post-war reforms. The leadership of both parties were now agreed on a welfare state and a mixed economy. There was also a consensus about foreign policy and the interests of the British state abroad. The left wing of the Labour Party, led by Anuiran Bevan, pressed for policies involving a major extension of public ownership and cuts in the defence programme.
That's why it seems to me that if we are to safeguard employment in Great Britain, we have to be resolute about it and clear about it and say we can only safeguard employment for British workers by socialist planning in Great Britain and socialist planning in other parts of the world. It's the only answer we can make. It's not the American answer. America hasn't found the answer. America is bewildered. Russia hasn't found the answer. But we have found it. And for God's sake, let's hold our heads up and apply it with all the courage you possess.
Bevanites were a substantial minority within the party. They were opposed by the right-wing union leaders who backed Gaitskell for the party leadership. The Bevanites were defeated. Bevan was himself expelled from the Parliamentary Labour Party for opposing nuclear weapons. The post-Korean War boom appeared to give credence to Labour's new right-wing philosophy. When Gaitskell became leader of the Labour Party, the word capitalism disappeared from Labour Party policy documents. At the next election, the Tories trebled their majority. These were the years of wonder, Mac, and you've never had it so good.
It's Golden Jubilee year for the Ideal Home Exhibition. And though it's bigger than ever, the idea is the same. To mix the things you can afford with the things you can't, so that you'll be dazzled without being depressed. This Unity House, for example, cost only £1,000, which is about as low as prices can go these days. But no one can deny it's attractive. Here's the lounge. And here's the main bedroom.
But the economic miracle was less secure than it appeared. Profit and growth rates were lower than in other European countries. More days were lost in strikes in 1958 than at any time since 1926. Disputes occurred over speed-ups in working practices and the imposition of automation. The seeds of crisis grew. Multinationals increasingly dominated economic and political life. When the Ford's multinational took over Briggs Motors, they at once set out to destroy the union organisation on the shop floor.
In the Ford main plant, the union structure had been developed in such a way that the workers on the shop floor had no say whatsoever in union policy. Whereas in Briggs, a very complicated trade union structure had developed, where in every shop in the factory, by a shop, I mean a place like a tool room, press shop, trim shop, or something like this, they would elect one, two, or three shop stewards and also a shop committee. Now, Ford's main tactic was to break this structure, which was a basic democratic structure. And in this, they had the support of the trade union leaders.
There was a union within a union at Briggs?
No, I think that all the shop stewards in Briggs are loyal to their respective unions, and the joint shop stewards setup is a common setup right throughout Britain, and if they attempt to smash it in Briggs, it would affect thousands of factories up and down this country. It's a confederation setup, really.
You were described as an agitator. Are you an agitator?
All the time, I was subjected to an unremitting press campaign. They did things like hire a room opposite my house and photograph all the front windows to see what sort of books I read.
What will you do about getting a job if they persist in their attitude?
Well, Judge Cameron has pretty well blacklisted me with that report of his, so it would be very difficult for me to find employment.
1956 was a year of upheaval for the left in Britain. In the Soviet Union, the Secretary-General of the Communist Party, Khrushchev, astonished the outside world by admitting that Stalin's regime had been based on terror, that in the treason trials of the 30s, confessions had been extracted by torture, and that the cult of personality surrounding Stalin had been used to obscure the crimes of his regime.
We were forced to go back and look at Marxism a lot more closely than we had, and to accept that there was no specific pattern for achieving socialism. I think that certainly didn't shake my conviction that Marxism was the only way in which society could be changed, but it certainly made us think more carefully about application of Marxism to change in society.
In October 1956, following a wave of strikes, a rising broke out in Hungary. The rebels demanded the democratization of Hungarian life and the end of a blind copying of Russian methods.
Basically, this had been a mockery of socialism. People had, you know, danced in the streets in 1949 in Budapest. That was the great May Day of nationalization. And they thought that working people were going to have the power. But in fact, the power had been usurped by a gang of bureaucrats just doing what the Russians told them, supported by a grossly overpaid and brutal secret police, the AVO people. And people just had had enough of that by 1956.
The Hungarian government called in Soviet troops, but a general strike was declared. Workers' councils and revolutionary committees were set up. The Soviet Union portrayed the uprising as a fascist plot. American agencies, like Radio Free Europe, claimed that it was an anti-socialist revolt. And no doubt Western agents and reactionary elements were active. But support for the uprising was strong in the Hungarian working class, which was subject to intense pressure to increase production. When Soviet troops finally put down the uprising, one of the last centres to fall was the factory area of Budapest. In the British Communist Party, there were those who refused to face up to the realities behind Khrushchev's speech and the invasion of Hungary. Others left the party.
7,000 people left the party, more or less. That's the figure. What kind of people? Oh, every kind. One of my closest friends, Donald Renton, who fought in the International Brigade, was a commissar. He had been the secretary of the Communist Party in Edinburgh, and I was organiser to his secretary. And who, if you had dared to say a word of criticism of the Soviet Union to Donald, you were immediately in a very difficult position, let's put it that way. Donald was one of the first to go.
I'm a true communist.
The 1957 Communist Party Annual Congress was a stormy one.
This conference has shown that our party is as firm as ever it was for the victory of socialism in this country and throughout the world.
What about the 7,000 members you've lost in the last year?
A lot of those will come back, and many more than 7,000 will come back when our party gets into action reporting the results of this conference.
Application for readmission to the party was turned down. Yes. What are you going to do now?
Well, I remain a communist, and I shall continue to fight for the transformation of this party into a genuine communist party.
Can you tell me why you remain a communist?
Because I believe in Marxism, and I believe that the application of Marxism to Britain and Britain and British conditions is the only real guarantee of a decent future for the British people.
Those on the left who opposed Soviet intervention in Hungary were equally opposed to British imperialist adventures in Egypt. In a clumsy conspiracy with France and Israel, Britain attacked Egypt for daring to nationalise the Suez Canal. It was an attempt to assert Britain's place as a power in the Middle East, and to protect oil interests there. At first, Labour backed the war, but later joined a broad campaign of opposition.
Sir Anthony Eden has been pretending that he is now invading Egypt in order to strengthen the United Nations. Every burglar, of course, could say the same thing. He could argue that he was entering the house in order to train the police. So if Sir Anthony Eden is sincere in what he is saying, and he may be, then if he is sincere in what he is saying, then he is too stupid to be a prime minister.
But the Labour leaders asked the trade union movement not to intervene by taking industrial action during the crisis. It was not Labour's opposition, but the disapproval of the United States government that caused Britain to withdraw from Suez. Over the next 10 years, Britain's role as a colonial power was to undergo a fundamental change. In 1952, the Tories had sent troops to Kenya to crush an African independence movement, inspired by the outrageous appropriation of tribal lands by white settlers. The Land Freedom Army, which led the armed rebellion, was portrayed by British propaganda as nothing more than blood-drinking savages. The rebellion was brutally suppressed. 80,000 Kenyans were detained in concentration camps.
The search for Dedan Kimathi ended at Nyeri police station after the Mau Mau leader had been captured. He was trying to escape into the forest, which has known his reign of terror ever since the emergency began 4 years ago. Leopard skins were the badge of his evil office. His capture is a powerful blow at the weakening morale of those few gangsters still trying to evade the security net which is inevitably closing round them.
Realising that the nationalist movements could not be kept in check indefinitely, the British ruling class decided that independent states could be tolerated, provided they were also client states. In 1960, Macmillan visited Central Africa.
I spoke in some of my speeches what I called the wind of change, which is blowing through the continent. That's true. There's a ferment of thought and activity. But that doesn't mean that all the cheerfulness, the merry character, of course that's what the African people are, merry people, the happy cheerfulness and colour of the old Africa isn't still there. Of course it is. I saw a lot of that. But building up by the side of it, there is all this great material progress of a spectacular kind, which European skill, industry and money has brought to Africa.
Particularly late 50s and early 60s, nearly all ex-colonies achieved their independence, political independence. That, no doubt, affected the metropolitan imperialist countries. So naturally, they had to adapt themselves in new situation. So this new form is how best they can have a sort of understanding, economic ties with the local national bourgeoisie.
As British influence declined, the United States moved in as the great neocolonial power. It was greatly aided by right-wing American unions, which lavished money to buy friends, goodwill, and agents in the leadership of the new unions in Africa and Asia. In an attempt to shore up Britain's dwindling status, the Tories decided to manufacture the hydrogen bomb. Its explosion in the Central Pacific in 1957 brought anti-H-bomb demonstrators onto the streets. At the Labour Party conference, Anuiran Bevan's answer to a motion calling for the abolition of nuclear weapons shocked the left of the party.
If you carry this resolution and follow out all its implications and don't run away from it, you'll send a British Foreign Secretary, whoever he was, naked into the conference chamber. Able to preach sermons, of course. Of course. Preach sermons, all right. And we can make good sermons. But unilateral action of that sort is not necessarily the way in which you take the menace of this bomb from the world.
Today, you've got many other examples of where people have said, well, let's take a softer approach and we can sort of crawl into power in carpet slippers. And the sad fact was that Nye Bevan, who was a tremendous force in left politics, then fell for it. And he joined up with Gaitskell, and there was the usual clasping of hands together at the Labour Party conference, and the press, the Tory press, went wild.
Bevan's defection meant that the left wing of the party was in disarray. But the growing opposition to nuclear armaments drew many different groups and tendencies into the campaign for nuclear disarmament. The establishment of US missile bases in Britain in 1958 gave the movement a focus and urgency.
Well, 1945 had seen the first use of nuclear weapons in Hiroshima in Japan. I think it's important to note that it was 12 years, 13 years, which was quite a long time, before there was any real movement against them. I mean, people were that glad that the war was over. We weren't really told all the facts about Hiroshima anyway. It was just another, a bigger bomb and the tale that it would prevent wars in the future. People were slightly relieved almost by it. There'd been the atrocities on the Burma Road and so on. So people were glad the war was over and weren't getting burned up a lot about the new weapons. But gradually, with the testing of nuclear weapons, people began to find strontium-19 milk and so on. And people began to get very concerned. And I think probably it was that kind of environmental aspect of it that began to move people, so that by 1958, CND was actually formed at a meeting in London of sort of top people around Canon Collins, and they decided on the first march to Aldermaston.
I therefore believe myself that the cross is a much more important symbol than the sword. And I believe that this march to Aldermaston and the whole of this campaign will succeed primarily because it is, in fact, the right thing.
The anti-nuclear movement grew in strength and influence. CND sought to change Labour Party and TUC policy. Their initial successes owed much to left-wing trade union leaders like Frank Cousins and Labour MPs like Ian McArdle.
But, Mr. Chairman, I passionately believe that our H-bombs and the existence in these islands of H-bomb bases not only does nothing to defend what we stand for, but directly and immediately jeopardizes and endangers our way of life. And I'm not prepared to see my loved ones go up in radioactive dust in order that we shall act as a sort of lightning conductor, a sort of decoy duck to draw the enemy fire onto our heads and divert it from New York and Chicago.
The 1960 Labour Party conference voted for unilateral disarmament. Gaitskell refused to accept the decision. His refusal led opponents of the bomb to move towards direct action. They formed the Committee of 100, which began confrontations with the state. Its members were frequently arrested and imprisoned. When 15,000 people attended a banned demonstration in Trafalgar Square, 1,300 were arrested, including the philosopher Bertrand Russell. The organisers of demonstrations against US bases were prosecuted under the Official Secrets Act. A group calling themselves Spies for Peace revealed the existence of a secret network of nuclear bunkers for top people only. Their revelations permanently damaged the notion that it would be possible to survive a nuclear war. High unemployment figures and a feeling that upper-class politicians were out of touch with the needs of the electorate led to a Labour victory in 1964.
I think we're long last going to get some planning into the economy. We're going to get more control.
Conservatives have done nothing since they've been in.
What do you predict for Britain under the socialists?
A change from mediocrity over 13 years.
Wilson came to power promising to harness the white heat of the technological revolution. But his policies added up to little more than the efficient and more compassionate management of an economic system based on private ownership and control, which he had no intention of challenging. When the seamen struck, he sided with the employers, and in an attempt to undermine support for the seamen, accused the strike leaders of being communist conspirators.
This is the sort of utterances that were made by the Tories against the Labour Party, the red herrings they were thrown across, the communist leadership in the Labour Party. This was the stuff that was used by the Tories a few years ago. and we see this stupid little man Wilson. Against him, against us, the seamen of this country and the workers of this country.
In foreign policy, he was quick to offer uncritical support for the American invasion of Vietnam.
Wilson's relationship with Johnson at the time of the Vietnam War was that of a poodle to its master. And, I mean, it was one of the most despicable periods, I think, of any Labour government. At the behest of American imperialism, the dominant imperialism in the world, it sacrificed any principles and any stances that it may have had in opposition in support of a war of bestiality, a war of oppression, and a war just after the raw materials and the political power in Southeast Asia. The British Labour government associated itself completely with the United States.
Opposition to the Vietnam War was widespread. Young people in particular were being drawn into politics to the left of the Labour Party. The Vietnamese liberation struggle united the left in many countries and across national boundaries. It inspired anti-colonial and civil rights movements throughout the world. The established order was threatened and American domination challenged.